Out-ish. Where's Jim? Is it?
I know.
Risen MHBC. I invite you to stand as we sing Christ is Risen this beautiful Easter morning.
Beneath the weight of all our sin, you bow.
Have a seat, everybody. Good morning and happy Easter to you. My name's Leslie. I'm one of the pastors here at Mount Hamilton. I'm so glad you're here today. It's a day we've been waiting for, haven't we? Especially after Good Friday, when things were not so celebratory. They're solemn. And today we are celebrating big time. Everybody should have one of these little shaky ribbon belly things. So if you have one of these on your chair, take the one that's on your chair, not the chair in front of you. We are glad you're here, whether you're a regular at Mount Hamilton. Maybe this is your first time coming. We're so thankful that you chose to come and be with us today. For those of you who need the washroom today and are unfamiliar, this door here leads you to the washrooms just down the hall, and feel free to go at any time. So this year we have these, I don't know what to call them, I call them ribbon shaky things. I mean, I'm sure there's a better name for them. And these are our celebratory ribbons that we're going to wave together. So whenever you hear, "He is risen," you're going to respond. And at that point, we'll do this, right? So let's try that. He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Awesome. We're also going to try and use that, you know, with some songs that you feel like it's just time to wave your ribbon shaky thing. You just go nuts.
Just like a waving ribbon shaky thing.
So we have a beautiful service for you today that's full of hope and full of joy and full of celebration. And so as we start our service, we're going to do a call to worship that's going to be on the screen. And I invite you to stand up. And we're not reading this responsively because it's Easter Sunday. We're going to read the whole thing together. Yesterday we thought death had won. Yesterday, we thought all was lost. Yesterday, we thought Christ was gone, but not today. Today, we know that love has won. Today, we know that hope is real. Today, we know that He is risen. Have risen to hope. We have reason to sing. Hallelujah! Hallelujah! Today, He is risen. He is risen indeed. Have a seat. Let's pray. God, we're so grateful for this day. Thank you for everyone who is able to come and be with us today. And we think of those who are not able to come to a service today. We pray you'd be with them as well on this day. We pray you'd be with each person here. And may your Holy Spirit flood this place. In Jesus' name, amen.
The exercise will continue. Back up.
Oh.
Out of the grave and in to life. My heart is yours, my soul is free. Thank you, God, for saving me. Thank you, God, for saving me. Thank you, God, for saving me. Suffered once for all, you made a way. Jesus, in victory you rose, you made us all your own. Now we are saved. You gave your life, you gave your life upon the cross. You suffered once for all. Cry out of the grave and into life. My heart is yours, my soul is free. Thank you, God, for saving me. Thank you, God, for saving me. Oh, thank you, God, for saving me. Thank you, God, for saving me.
And our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with his dumb power and love. Our God is an awesome God.
And our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom. God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God.
Have a seat, everybody. I'm going to invite Ashley and Jacob to come up to the front. You know, we get Easter everywhere we go, but when we're at church, we need to hear the story, right? And so the three of us are going to share that story with you. On Friday, we remembered Jesus' death, and we remembered how he was on the cross. He took the sins of the world on himself. We recall how he was arrested and tried and mocked and beaten, and how he was killed by hanging him on a cross. And after he died, two of Jesus' followers, they wrapped his body in cloth and put it in a tomb. And they had a stone, the governor wanted a stone rolled in front of it and an angel to sit, a guard to stand there to make sure everything was okay. And so this is what happened after that.
As was customary, three of Jesus's followers, also called disciples, brought spices and went to the tomb to anoint Jesus's body. Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James and Salome, headed to the tomb very early the first day of the week, just after sunrise. As they were on their way to the tomb, they asked each other, "Who will roll the stone away from the entrance of the tomb?"
But this didn't turn out to be a problem for the women. There was a violent earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven and, going to the tomb, rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothes were white as snow. The guards were so afraid of him that they shook and became like dead men.
The angel said to the woman, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus, who was crucified. He is not here. He told us that this would happen, and it is true. He is risen." There. "Come and see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples, 'He has risen from the dead and is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him. Now I have told you.'"
So the woman hurried away from the tomb, afraid yet filled with joy, and ran to tell the disciples. When they got there, they told them what they had seen.
When they heard this, Peter and another disciple responded by quickly heading to the tomb. Both were running as fast as they could, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent over and looked into where Jesus had been laying and saw the strips of linen lying there, but did not go in. Peter, who wasn't too far behind, got there and, with a little hesitation, went right into the tomb. He saw the strips of linen lying there, as well as the cloth that had been wrapped around Jesus' head. The cloth was still lying in its place, separate from the linens. Eventually, the other disciple, the one who got there first, went inside too. He saw and believed. And then they both went back to where they were staying, telling the others that he is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Now Mary stood outside the tomb crying. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb and saw two angels in white, seated where Jesus' body had been, one at the head and the other at the foot.
They asked her, "Woman, why are you crying?"
"They have taken my Lord away," she said, "and I don't know where they have put him." At this, she turned and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not realize that it was Jesus.
He asked her, "Woman, why are you crying? Who is it you are looking for?"
Thinking he was the gardener, she said, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have put him, and I will get him." Jesus said to her, "Mary?" She turned to him and cried out in Aramaic, "Rabboni," which means teacher.
Mary Magdalene went to the disciples and told them that she had seen the Lord, everything he said, and with joy let them know that he is risen.
He is risen indeed. Woo.
Hi, everybody. My name is Stephanie, and I am our Next Generation Director here at MHBC. Hi, everybody. So I am going to ask all of my friends, my kid friends, to come and sit up at the front along here. You might need to squish a little bit.
Don't kick any kids.
I want you guys to sit down so you can, like, see what's happening here. So you guys can, like, sit down this way and look this way.
Yes.
Yeah, so you're going to sit down here on the floor, and you're going to look this way. Yeah, down there on the floor. On the floor, guys. Down here on the floor. We're going to sit down on the floor. Down on the floor. Good job, guys. Oh, we have some big kids here. That's fine. Come as you are. We're all welcome. So, guys, I love Easter. I want to hear about some of the things that you guys like to do for Easter. Do you go for an Easter egg hunt? Yeah? Give me a thumbs up if you go for an Easter egg hunt. Awesome. Okay, do you have a special dinner? Not really. Somebody's going like this. I saw a sideways thumb, so like a kind of special dinner, maybe-ish. Do you get together with family? Yeah? All right. You know, one of my favorite things about Easter, you're not going to believe this, Easter jokes. Right? What's that? What is up with that? I love a good Easter joke. I really wish there was someone who could tell me a good Easter joke right now. Well, look at that. Joseph and Solomon just happened to have some good Easter jokes for us.
Good morning, America.
Canada.
Oh, good morning, Canada.
We're the Flute Boys, and we are here to tell you some excellent Easter jokes.
I hope you crack up.
We are really scrambling this morning to put this together.
What's the Easter Bunny's favorite sport?
I don't know.
Basketball.
Why did the Easter Bunny laugh? He heard a yoke.
What do Easter Bunnies do for fun? Karaoke.
You can't end on a terrible joke like that.
Do you have a better one?
Well, let's get serious here, folks. How does Easter end? With an R.
With an R.
Wah, wah, wah.
Thank you so much for that impromptu performance from the Fluid Boys. Who expected that?
With an R.
Okay, guys, I want to ask you, if any of you can remember why we celebrate Easter. Why do we celebrate Easter? Felicity. Jesus. What did Jesus do on Easter?
He came back from the dead.
That's right. He rose. He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Aw, can never get tired of that. Okay, guys. So I want to talk to you guys about your memory verse that you guys have been working on this month. So the grade 1 to 5 group have been working on a memory verse. Who remembers what the memory verse is?
Uh-oh.
Gabriel. Gabriel, do you remember what the memory verse is? Can you say it really loud? That's right. Jesus is not here. He is risen. Remember how... Remember how he told you he would rise. So I have some friends that are going to come up and show you the first part of that memory verse. We're going to all stand along here, and they're all going to have a little sign that's going to have a word on the memory verse, okay? So if I talk to you beforehand about being my helper, you can come on up now and stand on one of the numbers.
This is your job.
You can stand, oh, just stand on one because we have enough for like one for each, right?
Oh my gosh.
Felicity, you come on over here. Okay, I have extras now. Do you want to come and sit down over here? Okay. Come on over here. You can. Well, what happened here? Oh, Tobias. There you go. Number 9. All right. So Willow is going to hand each of you a card. Number 9 is way down there beside Addie. This is fun. Fun, right? So they're going to hide their verses or their words. And we're going to show them all at the same time. Can you guys say the memory verse with me again? Jesus is not here. He is risen. Nice. Okay, so everybody has their sign. We're gonna flip it around when I say 1, 2, 3. Ready? 1, 2, 3. Can we say it together?
Jesus here.
Jesus here.
Jesus
okay.
Here. Exclamation point, exclamation point. Is.
So it looks like we need to work on this a little bit. I guess they got a little jumbled. Do you guys think you can help put this in the right order? Yeah, you guys think you can? All right. Okay. So can you guys just come sit back here? What is the first word in that memory verse? Oh. So it looks like Maya's in the right spot. Check. So what is the second word? Okay, so who has is? Evan. All right, so Sophia, you're going to come on out. Sophia, you're going to come on out over here.
This is a beautiful mess.
Oh, you're just going to switch people. You hold your sign. Evan, you come over here. Sophia, you come over here. There you go. Perfect. So Jesus is... Not, so who has not? Okay, so Rose, I'm gonna get you to move down there. Jesus is not.
It's in Spanish.
And which one comes next? Jesus is not here. So here is gonna be on number 4. Gosh, this is a lot. Oh, exclamation mark. Alice, you can go on number 5. And then what comes after the exclamation mark?
He.
Who has he? Tobias. That's you, man. You can go on number 6 beside Alice. What is comes after he? Is.
Then risen exclamation mark.
You guys got it. You guys got it. All right. Can we say it all together? Ready and go.
Jesus is not here. He is risen.
He is risen indeed. All right. Can I get a big hand for all of my helpers today? You guys did. Pat on the back. You guys did a fabulous job. Okay. If you guys are ready, you can give me your signs and you guys can all go back to your seats. Thanks, everybody.
That was like beautifully chaotic. I love it.
Like Father, like Son. Well, let's take a closer look and see what's what. Every empire finds its rise built upon the backs of slaves. Yet behold, the Son of God coming with his kingdom already made. Heaven come down, unique masterpiece, bringing with him the master's peace. All the pieces of our lives will be justified, no longer consumed by this world's beast, even though we acted just like animals. 2 by 2, they ramped up into salvation's parameters. God alone thought to not let all lesser life be lost, to make a way led by one man as the waves were tossed. Though there be burden and cost, though Noah's name be dragged through the mud, sometimes a little water helps shape those God forms from the dust, or a lot of water. And in the course of time, Christ would add his blood. Where water's limits must recede, the blood goes further to intercede and demonstrate love. Yes, young lady. Though it may look quite senseless. Looking back on our own lives, sometimes we wonder what the sense is. Some days our heavy hearts get to leaning and we feel so tired while we're waiting for the meaning, but perspective isn't just seeing everything God's seeing. It's knowing where to look out on the horizon and keep watch for the promise to see the Son of God rising with healing in his wings. At my wit's end, defeated and totally undone, I cast my voice to the heights to catch the ear of God. I spoke up to the mountains, saying, "Where does my help come from?" And then you showed me. It couldn't be Moses or Elijah, but my mountain climber has spent some time in those caves, no stranger to the dark or the rock in the hard place. But 3 days later, his stone was rolling away. Now I give God the praise. Moment by moment, he considers my ways. I get lost in my days. Big picture, small picture, all the days. And let's not even talk about the holidays. We've all come a long, long way. And thank God we still don't live under the Mosaic law. Under that kind of pressure, our lives would be shattered like shards. And we still break. Yet in God's hands, the fragments of our lives become like mosaic art. Okay. That's just wordplay, but Jesus is the word of God, so let his word play and be the loudest voice at the boardroom table of your mind. You will find his words are always kind. When your thoughts start to drift, you start reliving your lows, start rehearing the labels. It's his spirit that lifts us, his truth that enables our next step. In our next step. And even if we misstep, God never sidesteps. He's with us in the tangle of life, teaching us his glide step. For any of our regrets or any of sin's pitfalls, Jesus took a wide step, crossed over the chasm and said, "Death can't have them." He's alive and he brings us with him. We have to tell the world that this is something different, something we get to celebrate. We toast it. See, our whole lives could cover these church walls, every moment written on a post-it, every highlight found in hindsight, but we would never find one to boast of. The life of Christ alone will truly shine. He's the first and the last from every sunset to sunrise in between. And now we might make a mess of our lives, but he will never leave. There's nothing we can do in terms of anything we could achieve. When God made the world, he just rested. And when Christ called out from the cross, "It is finished," we were given a pass on the test where we should have been tested. There's nothing left to add to that. There's only rejection or acceptance. And yet it feels so unsatisfying to parse through the record of our lives and realize there's not a single moment to hold out to God with merit. Yet for the humble in heart, eternity is theirs to simply inherit. No pride in our stride before God's throne, because pride is the thing that comes before the fall. You see, we just have no sense of how the love of God could be so intense. Like a father that carries a son lifted up, his love is hands on, hands outstretched, holes and wounds. For as hard as I've been to love, he has been unmoved. Right there, pinned to my cross for the sake of my darkest night. And believe me, I've gone back again and put up a fight. Yet I can't exhaust the patience of the one who lives outside of time. He brings a way. As sure as the sun brings the day, to make one thing clear, death is defeated. The enemy has no weapons left. Christ healed the mute, the blind, the deaf. And judging by how he dealt with those, and judging by how from death he rose, judging now by how the Son is like the Father, I can only judge a love unlike anything this world has to offer.
Getting ready to move into the baptism part of our service today. We're looking forward to that, and it's a real privilege for us to witness that, the baptism of Aaron and Alicia this morning. It's not only an important moment in their lives, it's a gift to us of symbols that tie so closely with what we're celebrating this weekend, this Good Friday and Easter. A word about baptism here at MHBC. It's important to say that in our Baptist tradition, the ritual of believers' baptism is a symbolic act. Not just symbolic, powerfully symbolic. It's a public act. It's a declaration that that person, that Alicia and Aaron, have put their faith in Jesus Christ, and they've made the commitment to be his follower. Baptism isn't the way, we don't believe baptism is the way that Jesus receives us into his kingdom family. It's a declaration of something that has already happened. And it isn't a confirmation that the one being baptized has everything figured out, has all the answers, could pass the test for God. It's not that at all. Instead, it's saying publicly that they are willing, they are committed to listening to God's call and to grow in understanding and love and to respond with a life that is in the process of being transformed by the Holy Spirit, all in their own unique ways that the Holy Spirit will transform them. And it's believers' baptism because it comes from a decision by the ones being baptized. It's very different from the ritual of infant baptism that's practiced in many other churches, maybe churches that are from your tradition. And we don't say that it's a better ritual. We say it's a different ritual. It has different symbols and different meaning behind it. And it's our ritual. I want to read a passage that clearly connects believers' baptism by immersion to what we are celebrating on this weekend. It's from the book of Romans, a letter written by the Apostle Paul to the church in Rome, and through that church written to all of us through the ages. Paul writes, "Or don't you know that all of us who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were therefore buried with him through baptism into death, in order that, just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life. For if we've been united with him in a death like this, we will certainly also be united with him in a resurrection like his. For we know that our old self was crucified with him, so that the body ruled by sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves to sin. Because anyone who has died has been set free from sin. And now if we died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him." Paul is giving us these images that when we're immersed in the water, it's a symbol of our joining in with the death on the cross and the burial of Jesus beneath the water for that moment. The power of sin defeated in death, and no longer will have power over us. It's not that we will never experience sin again. It's just that sin no longer controls our destiny. The effect is washed away. We're free. And when we come out from the water, it symbolizes that we are lifted up to a whole new life, resurrected as Jesus was resurrected, inheriting a life of freedom and a life that we can live in intimacy with God. Now, there's one other powerful symbol that we almost always see in baptism, and I think it's my favorite symbol, even though I admit it's not a biblical symbol. I think it's an important one just the same. We see it almost every time as the person being baptized is lifted up out of the water. It's the moment of pure joy that's on their face. A moment that will be sealed in their memory. And if we can get some pictures, it'll be sealed in the memory of our community, and it'll be sealed in the memory of everyone who witnesses it. And we'll recall days like today in our own lives. If we have been baptized, we will remember that moment, those days when God feels close to us and the days when he feels far away. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we give thanks for this beautiful gift of baptism, this gift that Aaron and Alicia are receiving from you, but it's also a gift that they are giving to us, to witness it, to see their faith being declared openly and with joy. And we who have been baptized will remember the days of our own baptism, the day when we maybe went into that tank, when we rose out of that water. We can remember the joy that we felt in our hearts and the smile on our faces. May it all bring us back to you. We give thanks, Lord, that you have given us this gift of intimacy with you that we celebrate this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen, amen. As we get ready for a joyous baptism, let's stand one more time as we sing an awesome song. Let's sing of God's amazing grace, church. What a beautiful day. Death has been defeated. He has conquered the grave. Give me your voices as we lift this up. Who breaks the power of sin and darkness?
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings.
King of glory, the King above all kings.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. He has conquered death and conquered the grave. He is risen. Oh, I just wanted to make sure you were paying attention. Plus, I wanted to get those things waving. All right, here we go. Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing. May be seated.
To begin, we're going to be introduced to our baptismal candidates, participants this morning. I want to introduce everyone here to Alicia O'Keefe. Alicia, you should come up and stand with me. She's going to be baptized in a few minutes. Alicia has attended MHBC for a long time. Since Susan Andrus started bringing her when Alicia was just a little girl, I'm figuring that's like 30 years ago. We're not going to get too detailed with dates, but quite a while ago. Alicia told me that she loved Sunday school. She loved the music. She even loved the sermons, even though they sometimes put her to sleep. But mostly she loved the people, both the adults and the other children who she found were kind to her and accepted her into the church family. Alicia also came to know Jesus here at MHBC, and her faith is as strong and as sure as anyone that I've ever met. Jesus has been with her through some really difficult times in her life, like at school when children weren't always kind, and especially when she lost her parents. Leslie and I had a great conversation with Alicia, and we were so impressed with the depth of her faith in Jesus. But I want you to hear that from Alicia herself, too. So I'm going to ask you a few questions. You might be a little nervous. But let's ask you this question. I want to ask you, who is Jesus to you?
He is my Lord and Savior, and I know that when he's with me, I am safe and nothing can go wrong. And I love him.
Oh, that's beautiful. And that's kind of the second question is a little bit in that. What difference has Jesus made in your life?
He's made me more, I don't know, Christianer.
That's good. That's
he's a, got
that's
Jesus. Good.
That's beautiful. Now, you told me that you believe God has, when we were talking, you said that God's given you a purpose to help people to know that they're special no matter what people might say about them. Can you say more about that?
I just think that we are all here for a reason, and if there is somebody here different than us, we should try to make them feel welcome to church and to come and not be afraid to say who Christ is.
Amen. And finally, the big question, why do you want to be baptized today?
I want to be baptized today because I feel that the Lord is telling me to do it so I can be closer and I can talk to him even more when I need to.
Oh, thank you. That's great. You did great. Well, thank you. Thank you, Alicia. Alicia's going to be baptized this morning in just a few minutes. But first, you can sit down. Oh, and why don't you introduce who you brought today?
And this is my...
A little closer to...
This is my sister, Jess.
Hi.
Jessica. Hey, Jess. And I brought her with me.
And your other friends.
Oh, and this is Daphne Parlin. I consider her my mom.
She's my mom too.
Get in. We're getting.
Yeah, I can breathe better now. She out all the way in the nose.
Thank you. And Wendy is in here, up here, helping everyone stay together and on task.
Yeah.
Thank you, Wendy, as part of the family. And now we'll hear from Aaron. If you can have a seat, and Aaron's going to come up. Aaron.
Good morning. He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
33 years ago, our precious son Aaron was born, a gift from God, but he was a child with Down syndrome. For Paul and I, this was one of the most traumatic and emotional days in our lives for many reasons. He was our first child. He was born with a disability we had yet to fully understand. He had a heart complication. And holding the sweet baby boy, all we saw was his life colored with medical challenges, unreasonable education evaluations, developmental uncertainties, and rejection from those who would see him as different. While our faith was strong, it left Paul and I with many questions we knew only God had the answers to. But we trusted God's plan for Aaron's life and had him dedicated as an infant. In later years, we helped Aaron give his heart to Jesus. And today, we stand here with joyous pride and emotion to share with all of you that Aaron, with our help, has made the decision to be baptized in what he calls the swimming pool. For those of you who know Aaron, know him to be kind and tender-hearted. Maybe you have received one of his warm hugs, a handshake, or a signature tap on the shoulder. He loves music, he loves to dance, he loves sushi. And he loves Jesus. Amen. Aaron, do you love Jesus?
Oh, yes, you do.
Yeah, buddy.
While we rarely question an individual's readiness when it comes to baptism, the enemy has always created this doubt in Paul and I as we question if Aaron was really ready, if he understands, if he truly has given his heart to Christ. But something happened this year when the church announced if anyone was interested in baptism. We felt the Holy Spirit turn our anxiety into peace, telling us to quit doubting and just let Aaron's faith and actions speak for themselves. Aaron loves coming to church, and he never asked to stay home. And when we arrive at church, he takes right off to go help Stephanie set up for children's church. Aaron loves Christian music. He loves the band. Aaron, what is one of your favorite songs that Chad sings?
Ooh, hey, House of the Lord.
Yeah, buddy.
When Aaron sees something beautiful in nature, like a rainbow, a waterfall, or a mountain, we will say, who created them? And he says, God did. And with great confidence, Aaron will tell you Jesus was born in a manger, he died on the cross, and that he is alive in heaven with his grandpa sitting on a porch swing. Aaron loves to pray. Aaron, who do you pray to?
My heart.
Oh, Jesus.
Jesus.
His bedtime prayers don't often make sense to us. We always hear, Dear Lord, as he starts, and Amen when he's finished. But what we've come to realize is that Jesus is the only one who really needs to understand his prayers. Amen. Aaron loves what is called his Bible book, often looking at the picture stories and talking out loud about those observations. For example, he'll call Noah's Ark the animal boat, but this gives us the opportunity to share with him the meaning of the stories. And while Aaron loves Jesus, he too is a sinner, just like you and me. He experiences a full range of emotions, just like you and me. And he needs a Savior, just like you and me. Romans 10:13 tells us that everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. We praise God that in this case, everyone means, well, everyone, including those with disabilities. Amen. Aaron, where does Jesus live?
In my heart.
We praise God for giving Aaron a simple faith to understand that he loves him. We believe Aaron is an image bearer of God with his own special ministry that could not be accomplished without that extra chromosome that makes him so unique. We also thank God for bringing us to a church that loves and respects the value of all people. We've been blessed by a loving church who embraces Aaron and encourages his spiritual gifts. Since attending MHBC in 2021, Aaron has helped cut the grass for the property team. He's been a greeter. He helps with hospitality events and helps me drop off donated items from Team Bless, telling me, show kindness, help people. Aaron's life hasn't been without physical and emotional suffering, yet our Jesus-loving son, yet as our Jesus-loving son, we have seen God work in and through Aaron's life in so many ways. Aaron is indeed a faithful follower of Jesus. And we believe he created Aaron with a special purpose, the same reason he made you and me, so that the work, the power, and the glory of the Lord might be put on display. May God continue to use Aaron as his image bearer and guide him through all the days of his life. Aaron, do you want to be baptized?
Oh, yes, you do.
So who's here with you? Who's this behind you?
Oh, it's my dad.
No, it's my dad. It's my dad.
And we have heard how much you love Jesus and your beautiful faith. Do you want to be baptized?
Sure.
Sure.
She's coming now. She's just going to be 1 second. She has to take care of something on her brace, and she's coming.
Thank you.
So Alicia, are you ready to be baptized?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, we've heard a beautiful story of faith, and we are so happy to be here with you for this moment today. Who is the Lord of your life?
Jesus Christ.
Jesus Christ, I now baptize you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Oh boy, and now we have to follow that by singing. Have fun with that.
I invite you to stand. As we sing about our marvelous and wonderful God. Wasn't that awesome?
How marvelous, how wonderful. God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
You can be seated.
Well, we've celebrated the resurrection of Jesus in a number of ways already this morning. We've responded to the news that Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
We've listened to the whole story from Scripture. We've witnessed it powerfully demonstrated through two baptisms. And after I'm finished, we're going to begin to really turn up the dial on our celebrations. After. You know, celebration has always been an important religious practice. Life in the Old Testament was arranged around the festivals and the feasts that called the people to the temple at least three times a year to participate in practices that sometimes included fasting, but always included feasting, from austerity to outright joy. There's a whole collection of psalms called Psalms of Ascent, and they were worship songs that the excited Jewish pilgrims would sing as they traveled to Jerusalem for one of these great feasts. And many of them were songs of pure joy and celebration. Example, the first three verses of Psalm 126. This is a song they would sing on the way to the temple. When the Lord restored the fortunes of Zion, we were like those who dreamed. Our mouths were filled with laughter, our tongues with songs of joy. Then it was said among the nations, the Lord has done a great thing for them. The Lord has done great things for us, and we are filled with joy. On Palm Sunday, even though we know that crowd really completely misunderstood Jesus' intentions, they showed us how ready the Passover festival goers were to celebrate, cheering Jesus loudly as he approached the city. But real celebrations, real feasting come best after a season of fasting. In the same way that a special meal always tastes better if you haven't been feasting for the whole week before it, kind of like that third turkey dinner at Christmas. It's still a turkey dinner, but it's not like the first turkey dinner you had. Well, we've been preparing ourselves for this day in more ways than just planning the decorations or the party that's to come. On Good Friday, we heard the story of Jesus' arrest and burial, crucifixion and burial. We heard it once again, and we received it slowly, in a darkened and undecorated sanctuary with no fanfare at all. And leading up to this week, over the six Sundays of Lent, we took time to quietly examine our faith. We followed as a church a daily prayer schedule, and we remembered the highlights and the dark times of our own stories of faith through weekly reflection questions. And we even place those questions along the wall as a way to offer them up to God, but also to join all of our stories together. And this morning, as we see the mosaic of the sunrise here, those answers that we had are, if you get close enough at some point, you can see that those answers that we put up on the wall are all worked into this mosaic, this sunrise that we celebrate on this Easter Sunday morning. And we did all that, and because we were willing to do that work, because we were willing to slow down and and ponder tough questions and spend some time quietly in God's presence, the celebration that we celebrate today is all the more sweet. Jesus is alive. He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
And as the baptisms symbolically reveal, the power of sin has been broken. We are called to a new life, a life in God's presence living in us. This new life in Jesus is available to everyone. John chapter 3, verse 16, a well-known verse, God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him, whoever puts their trust in him, will not perish but receive eternal life. And that eternal life can begin right here and right now. Now, I have to admit, this is my first Easter Sunday here at MHBC. And as the celebrations were planned, I sometimes wondered if they were maybe a little over the top. There's certainly like nothing I've ever experienced before. And if you're new to the idea of Jesus, or if you haven't spent much time thinking about your faith and considering it over the last couple of months, you might wonder what all the fuss is about. You might wonder, is it just a lot of hype? And that's a fair question. But for those of us who have searched our hearts, have spent time in prayer with those challenging questions, who have considered our own personal stories with God and who have come away filled with a heightened gratitude and joy, is it possible to celebrate too much? Jesus came preaching the good news that the kingdom of God has come near. God sent his son to bring his presence to the earth in a new and more intimate way. And God has revealed this in its fullness through Jesus' willingness to suffer and even die for us, and through his resurrection. And we have been invited to share in both. He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. And therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Amen.
All right, I'm going to ask members of my Easter choir to come to the front, please. This is the fun part. This was a lot of fun to do, as it was last year. This year we opened it up to everyone, and I'm very happy about that. Got some younger members of our congregation joining us as well. So this is something that kind of grew organically over the last few Sundays after church. And I want to say thank you to all of you that gave of your time and of your efforts. I opened up to everybody. I said, you don't have to be a great singer. You just have to love to sing. So I'm grateful to have this happening here today as we're getting ready to sing for you.
Blessed assurance.
Thank you very much, beautiful choir. You guys can go and be seated. Thank you. All right, I'm going to ask you to get on your feet, because this is where we get happy. I'm not very good at standing, but this is very much a standing song. Let's sing Happy Day. One, two, one, two, three, oh! He is risen. He is risen indeed. Let's go.
Greatest day in history. Death is beaten. Have rescued me. Sing it out, Jesus is alive. Empty cross, the empty grave. Life eternal, you have won the day. Shout it out, Jesus is alive. He's alive. Life eternal, you have won the day. Shout it out, Jesus is alive. He's alive. Oh, happy day, happy day. You washed my sin away. Oh, happy day, happy day. I'll never be the same. Oh, wash my sin away. Oh, happy day, happy day. I'll never be the same. Forever I am changed.
When I stand in that place,
when I stand in that place, free at last, meeting face to face, I am yours. Jesus, you are. This joy, perfect peace. Earthly pain finally will cease. Celebrate, Jesus is alive. He's alive.
Sharing an Easter with us this morning. Glad you're getting there. We're still going. There's face painting setting up at the front. There are treats at the back. Please stick around. Jesus is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Amen. Thank you.
Reprise? Yeah.
Let's just play Happy Day again.
One, two, three.
Sam's done. If Sam's done, well done.
Good job, guys.
Thank you, everyone. I know this is always hectic, so. Yeah. Most of all, thank you, Sam, for saving up all your pills.
Yay!
I feel like you were up here.
She was in the good seats.
We were about to drag you up here. But you're ready up here.
Yeah. I was like, when are these credits going on?
I was watching.
And all of a sudden, they just all started going. I was like, okay.
I know.
All right, brother. Oh, I can leave my space now.
Thank you.